Allies for Gina and Shelly were in short supply. No one would trust Gina except for possibly one organisation, the Hooded Claw. This guild of assassins was founded by the vampire's sworn enemies, the Vandals. The vampires and the Vandals had been at war with one another since long before the creation of Tyros. Long before recorded history began, in fact. The Vandals were created by the sworn arch-rival of the father of the vampires, Castram, which is what started their never-ending feud. Despite this, however, the Vandals were, ironically, among the closest relatives to the vampires, with their creator being of the same race of demons as Castram. The Vandals even shared many weaknesses and powers with their vampire enemies, but a key difference between them was that Vandals fed on their victims' souls with their claws, rather than their blood. The Hooded Claw, despite its name, was not just made up of Vandals. It also included beasts, monsters, demons of all kinds, and even human assassins too. Furthermore, the Hooded Claw would offer its services to anyone provided they could pay highly enough, though for obvious reasons it did not provide any services to or employ any vampires. The money raised from the Hooded Claw's activities was used to help fund the Vandals' ever-growing empire throughout Tyros, though it was still neither as large nor as evil as the vampires. Shelley didn't think that the Hooded Claw would give Gina the time of day in more than the larger cities, but fortunately, the Vandals had a way of knowing if someone was telling the truth, that admittedly caused tremendous pain for the person enduring it, but Gina was used to pain by now. Sure enough, as soon as Gina arrived at the Guild of the Hooded Claw alone, she was captured. The head of the guild, the oldest vandal on the planet, had the power to read someone's soul. Again, it wasn't quite mind-reading, but it was an extremely advanced form of soul-reading that could tell if someone was lying. Vandals fed on their victims by stabbing their claws into the victim's stomach, where they would pull their souls out and consume them in their hands. However, if they were careful, then a vandal could simply use their claws to read a person's soul. Very few vandals had mastered the power, however, as it was an extremely delicate process. It was still the worst agony for the people it was inflicted on, as the vandal was not only cutting into their flesh, but their souls too. Gina luckily survived it, more due to the experience of the Vandal Elder, though she had a feeling that the head of the guild kept it going for longer than necessary just to torment her. The Vandal agreed to help Gina sneak her way into the camp, though there was much disagreement on how. The Vandals wanted to launch a full-scale attack against the vampires and even threatened to torture Gina into giving them all the information they needed. However, Gina, who had come alone, said that she had left all of the secrets with Shelley, and that if anything happened to her, then they would be revealed to all of the cities. Gina did not want a massive full-scale attack, as she was afraid it would endanger the prisoners, who the vampires would all instantly slaughter if they were overpowered. She also felt that a sneak attack would be more successful, as the vampires would never see it coming. Reluctantly, the Vandals' leader, not wanting to let a golden opportunity to bring down the vampires go, agreed to send 5 of the guild's best assassins to help Gina and the others. They included a monster assassin named Kreleg, who resembled a humanoid with 6 arms, a snake-like lower body instead of legs, a bald head, and a single red eye which looked more like a long strip across its face. His teeth, meanwhile, were large and overlapping, and unlike most monsters of his kind who had green skin, his was black, with a red stripe down his back and stomach. Among his powers, aside from advanced strength and near indestructibility, included the ability to fire acid from his mouth. Another of the assassins was a Venusian named Trialex, who was one of the most prominent and long-lived assassins in the guild. Unlike many of the others, however, he had a code of honour and would never take the lives of those he deemed to be innocent. The third assassin was a witch named Laressa, who was famous for casting some particularly vicious curses and punishments to those who she was chosen to assassinate. She was by far the most despicable and loathsome member of the guild, but Gina wasn't throwing any stones at that point. The fourth assassin was a vandal named Fastian, who had more spectral powers than other breeds. Just as with vampires, there were many different breeds of vandal. Fastian's breed could form into mist, walk through walls, and make their bodies transcendent, though they couldn't do so indefinitely, and doing so for too long could leave them weak afterwards. The fifth and final assassin was a Caradon named Makos, a magical creature that was the combination of a shark and a human being with extraordinary powers. He was by far the most violent and unpredictable of the assassins. Needless to say, Shelley was somewhat uncomfortable with the team Gina had assembled, and Laressa in particular had fun tormenting Shelley by letting her know some of the most gruesome curses she had inflicted on her victims over the years. Makos also quickly got into a fight with the owl, with Gina herself having to separate them. Perhaps not surprisingly, Trilex was the most friendly and understanding towards Gina and her new friends. He knew of Gina's exploits and even told her that at one point he would have happily collected her head. But much like Shelley, he believed that she wanted to and was capable of change. Whilst the assassins may not have been happy with it, Gina was still the leader of the team due to her greater knowledge of the vampires. Gina knew the exact weak points of the camp and where would be the best place to strike. Ironically, in much the same way as she had done to the very first allied camp that she had helped Classia take down, Gina planned to use magic to counteract the vampires' force field from within, though she would not bring it all down at once. Not only were the vampire spells too powerful for that, but if that ever happened, the vampire's first policy would be to slaughter their prisoners to make sure that none of their secrets would get out. Gina instead hoped to weaken the force field at certain points from inside to allow the assassins to sneak in. When Gina arrived at the vampire's camp, it was among the few times she saw the vampire queen smile. Gina tried not to let the feelings of genuine affection she had built up towards her phony mother return. It would be so easy for her to fall back into the old habits once she was in Clasia's care again. But Gina just kept the memory of people dancing in the streets at the news of her being tortured to death in her head. The vampire questioned Gina on what had happened to her, but Gina lied, stating that she was washed up in the woods and forced to flee from a pack of raptors for a few days. Classia seemingly bought it, only because she had no idea her magical shock collar didn't work on Gina anymore. She took Gina to see the man who had tortured her and gave her daughter a chance at revenge. Gina instantly started to beat him viciously. Hurting someone now sadly came as naturally to Gina as anything else. After a few minutes, however, she managed to control herself and stopped, much to Clasia's surprise and disappointment. "What is wrong?" Clasia asked sincerely. "I'm a bit tired and he went down too easily. Can I have a minute or two to rest and get more creative with how I'm going to hurt him?" Gina said. Clasia wasn't buying it. She hadn't seen that kind of look on Gina's face for a long while. It almost looked like remorse. "Just what did happen to you out there, Gina? I hope when they had you prisoner, they didn't help you reconnect with your roots," Clasia asked. Gina laughed in response. "People who tortured me, you mean? Who danced in the streets when they thought I was dead?" "How did you know they celebrated your death if you were out in the woods for all that time?" Clasia asked. Oh, I heard it from a soldier I ran into who was angry that I wasn't dead. Classia still wasn't buying it, however.
Oh, Gina, I want to believe you, I really do, but if you weren't lying, you'd be on the floor by now.
Classia said as she raised the device she normally used to activate Gina's collar many times before. Gina still tried to keep up the bluff, but it was no use.
Don't insult my intelligence, Gina. I don't know how they did it. But rest assured, I'll have another one on you in no time.
Classia said as she lifted up another glowing sphere. Gina was terrified of being under Clasia's control again. So much so she even lifted a knife out and held it to her own stomach.
I mean it. I'd rather die than go back to being your slave, Gina said.
If that were true, you would have killed yourself years ago. You don't expect me to believe that you would ever put someone else above yourself. I suspect that this little display is more down to your wounded pride than anything else. You can't stand the fact that I've always beaten you, always broken you, and now you think you are free. You're undoubtedly willing to risk goodness knows how many fools who tried to help you get his lives with this suicide mission.
Classia taunted. With no other options, Gina fled, but Classia was too fast and soon caught up to and overpowered her former student. Still, in the ensuing struggle, Gina was able to land a lucky blow with her knife straight into Clasia's eye. The vampire doubled back in pain, and Gina then grabbed the glowing orb from her hand, which she threw at a nearby wall behind Clasia, breaking it. The dark magic, however, created a massive explosion that blew both Gina and Clasia dozens of feet across the room and buried them under masses of rubble. Neither were killed, but both were knocked out, and the alarms were soon raised. Thinking that the vampires had discovered Gina's ruse, the assassins abandoned her more subtle approach and began to attack the vampires, or rather Makos did. He made his presence known by bursting out of the ground he had been crawling under, in first before two vampire guards, who he then dispatched by biting both of their heads off at the same time. Fastian and Laressa soon came to Makos' aid, though not because they wanted to actually help him, just because it gave them a chance to fight. They made short work of the dozens of vampires that attacked. Laressa turned several of the vampires into bugs and squashed them, though she also turned one vampire into a statue, and then another into a hammer, which she used to smash the statue before breaking the hammer to pieces. She then turned another vampire into a crucifix, which caused his entire body to burn up, though, just before it did, she used the burning cross to impale three more vampires, causing them to burn up too. Probably her most creative attack, however, was turning one vampire into a mouse, and then another into a hawk that ate him, and then yet another vampire into a tiger to eat the hawk, and then another into an alligator to eat the tiger, and then another into grizzly bear, who disemboweled the alligator, and then finally another into Keratosaurus, who killed the grizzly and several more vampire soldiers. Kreleg and Triolex, meanwhile, wisely continued a more stealthy approach and made their way towards the mine in the hopes of freeing the prisoners. Kreleg didn't actually care one bit about the prisoners, but he was under orders from Gina. Shelly, the owl, and the centaur all searched for Gina. Unlike the others, Shelly, even if she wouldn't admit it, was worried about Gina, and she used the owl's keen sense of smell to try and locate the former traitor. Ordinary Tyrannosaurus rexes had among the keenest sense of smell of any animal ever to live on the planet. The owl led them to Clasia's quarters, which were guarded by two white wolverines. These creatures were the children of two werewolves, born in wolf form. They possessed no humanity, and were far stronger than regular werewolves, or indeed most species of earthly demon or beast. There was absolutely no way anyone could hope to sneak past them, as their senses were every bit as refined as the owl's. The hybrid dinosaur shook Shelly off its back and made its presence known to the two wolves with a roar. Both wolverons then started to circle the little dinosaur, who still stood its ground. Soon, the wolves attacked the dinosaur at the same time, with one going for its neck and the other its tail. The owl dodged the wolf that went for its neck, though the other wolveron managed to grab its tail. Reacting quickly, the owl delivered a deep bite onto the wolf facing its head's arm, drawing blood. Its scream briefly distracted the other wolveron to the point where the owl was able to pull its tail free and wrap it around the demonic wolf's throat. Though even the owl's tail didn't have enough strength to break the wolveron's neck, it was still able to choke its enemy to the point where it was knocked out. The other wolveron, meanwhile, sunk its fangs into the owl's back. With any normal creature, that would have been enough to sever its spinal column in half, but the owl's magical constitution allowed it to persevere, albeit in tremendous agony. Indeed, the dinosaur had never quite felt a force like it, but it continued to bite onto the wolf's arm, and as its bite was so much more powerful than several wolverons combined, eventually the white wolf relented and howled in pain, waking up its partner. The wolveron then used the claws on its other arm to slash at the dinosaur's face, and this time was actually able to make the dinosaur release its arm, as the reptile was scared of being stabbed in the eye. The wolveron then tried to further attack the dinosaur with more scratches to the face, but the owl used its tail to trip the wolveron and then delivered a flurry of quick but powerful bites to the wolf's stomach, disemboweling it in no time. The other wolveron then charged at the dinosaur, managing to knock it off balance and pin it to the ground before delivering a series of furious slashes. The owl, however, though overwhelmed at first by the barrage of attacks, soon pushed through them and used its body weight to knock the wolveron on its back, after which it then latched its jaws around the wolf's head. The wolveron fought as hard as it could, but the pressure of the owl's jaws was just too great, and in seconds it punctured through the wolveron's skull, its brain, and eventually it crushed the demonic white wolf's head completely. The other wolveron, meanwhile, despite its injuries, was not dead. It held its guts in place with the arm the owl had torn into. The wolf almost couldn't figure out what was happening to it. Normally a wound like this, unless it was made of silver, wouldn't even register for a wolveron, as its healing factor would have repaired it. The jaws of the owl, however, aside from being tremendously strong, also contained dark magic, which could affect the majority of supernatural creatures and ensure that the animal's jaws could harm them as easily as it could an ordinary animal. The wolveron's loyalty to its vampire mother, however, overrode everything else, and the animal made a last foolish charge at the owl, which responded with another whack of its tail, which sent the wolveron crashing into the ground, with its arm falling away from its guts, which fell out of its stomach in the process. As it lay there, in a pool of its own blood and intestines, the owl finished the wolveron off by wrapping its tail around its throat and choked the life out of the white beast before letting out a roar of triumph. Meanwhile, Shelly and the centaur made their way into Clasia's room, only to see half a dozen or so vampires desperately pulling several pieces of rubble away from her. Careful not to alert them, Shelly and the centaur headed to where Gina was, who they could see poking out from under more rubble a few feet away, and tried to help her out. Gina came too with Shelly's help. She was burned down one side of her body, but her constitution allowed her to overcome it. Meanwhile, Classia, after coming to, soon pushed all of the rubble off herself and instantly headed for Shelly and the centaur, which raised its club in defence. Classia, however, easily knocked the beast's club out of his hand and sent the cyclops crashing to the ground with one strike, before turning her attention to Shelly, who she grabbed by the throat. "What did you do to her? How dare you think you can steal her away from me? Do you have any idea how long I worked on her?" Classia said. Whilst meanwhile, Gina picked up the centaur's club and used it to stake two of Clasia's vampire lackeys from behind whilst they were distracted laughing at Shelley's plight. The other vampires turned to face Gina, but fortunately the cyclops jumped on two of them from behind and gave the other a slash to the face with its claws, which sent him tumbling back onto the club Gina held out. Gina then staked the other two while they were pinned under the centaur's legs before going to face Classia. While she was still stronger than Gina, Shelly, or the centaur, the blast had weakened Classia to a greater extent as she had been closer to it. She held her talons to Shelly's throat, telling Gina to let her go or she would kill her. For a second, Gina attempted to call Clasia's bluff, but as soon as the vampire queen drew Shelly's blood with a shallow cut, Gina put down her club. "How disappointing. I don't know what they did to you, but..." Before Classia could finish, the owl suddenly came bursting into the room. As the dinosaur closed in on the vampire queen, she drew more blood from Shelly, only to be interrupted again by more vampire guards coming up from behind the owl, who instantly went for the dinosaur. Seizing her chance, Classia threw Shelly into Gina and ran out of the room as fast as she could, leaving her guards to be slain by both the owl and the centaur. Gina instantly ran after her, but soon saw the vampire queen had fled completely when she got outside. Sadly, Gina didn't have time to chase her. Her first priority was helping the prisoners escape, including even her former torturer. As he lay there, curled up, whimpering and helpless, Gina was still tempted to stick a knife in him, but thankfully she didn't want to give her mother the satisfaction. Instead, she, along with Shelly, helped him over the owl's back as they rode away to help the others. Down in the mines, Kreleg and Triolex had succeeded, after easily disposing of a few vampire guards to shut down the force field that was surrounding the mine where the prisoners were trapped. Unfortunately, dozens more vampire guards soon arrived to detain them. Armed with magical whips that could cut through their victims' bones, the vampires tried to push the mob of already cowed and terrified prisoners back. Kreleg and Triolex did their best to fight the vampires off, but they were soon outnumbered and surrounded. Gina, however, soon came to their rescue, riding on the back of Owl, along with Shelly, and wielding a silver sword, a weakness of many breeds of vampire. Gina rode past the vampires with the owl's incredible speed and sliced several of their heads off. The owl's lightning-fast reflexes also allowed her to dodge the vampire's whips, while Shelly sprayed holy water on the vampires who weren't decapitated, causing them to go up in flames. Whilst the vampires turned their attention towards Gina, Kreleg and Triolex led the prisoners down the passageway Gina had told them about, though not before she gave them her former torturer and told the two assassins to get him to safety with the others. Triolex would carry him down the tunnel until they reached the end, which was a giant underground lake. Unfortunately, it was the home of a Spinosaurus that guarded the lair, but Gina still felt that was the safest way out. The Spinosaurus that was almost 60 feet long soon rose out of the lake, roaring at the top of its lungs. The vampires regularly fed it people they captured in the forest, but sadly, the great reptile was seemingly always hungry due to the dark magics the vampires infected it with that had turned it into a caricature of its former self. Kreleg was the first to attack the Spinosaurus, spitting acid in the giant dinosaur's face as it leaned in to bite at them. He managed to hit it in its tongue and near its eye. For the first time in its life, the Spinosaurus actually retreated somewhat, but as Kreleg moved to hit the dinosaur several more times, it began to panic and lunged forward out of the lake. Triolex told Kreleg to stop, but the monster was as arrogant as he was bloodthirsty and kept attacking the Spinosaurus. The sail-backed dinosaur fought through the barrage of acid and swiped Kreleg away with one of its claws. Such a blow from the Spinosaurus's massive claws would have sliced an ordinary human in two, but Kreleg, whilst cut, was simply thrown across the room. Unfortunately, however, Triolex was not quite as durable and was forced to flee from the Spinosaurus. He desperately tried to hurry the prisoners back the way, with another one of the prisoners carrying Gina's former torturer, but sadly the Spinosaurus caught up to several at the back. It picked one up in its jaws and swallowed him whole, whilst it sliced a further two in half with its claws and speared another through the torso with its left claw like a fish. Triolex stabbed the beast in the leg with one of his swords, but its skin was so thick he was only able to make a shallow cut. Still, at the very least, it distracted the Spinosaurus long enough for the last of the prisoners to make their way back up the tunnel. The Spinosaurus, however, responded with a kick to Triolex, knocking him several feet backwards and breaking his arm in the process. The Spinosaurus then walked slowly towards its cornered prey. In the 300 years he had faced demons, vampires, monsters and werewolves, Triolex had never been so terrified as when the 60-foot-long reptile stood right in front of him and slowly opened its jaws. Before it could swallow him whole, Kreleg bombarded the beast with another round of acid, this time hitting it in the tail. The dinosaur spun around, screaming and waving its tail frantically in the air. Kreleg, whose claw wound had already healed, then jumped through the air and landed on the Spinosaurus's face. It tried to use its claws to pull him off, but Kreleg was too quick for the dinosaur and slithered on top of its head, after which he wrapped his tail around its throat and used his six arms to pull the dinosaur's jaws open. He then started to spit his acid down its throat and onto its tongue. Kreleg's vicious attacks, however, didn't last long, as the Spinosaurus used one of its claws to slice his tail off, after which it shut its jaws, cutting off all six of his hands in the process, before he slid off its neck and onto the floor. The Spinosaurus then impaled Kreleg through the stomach with one hand, and prepared to slice his head off with the other. Triolex, however, intervened, throwing a dagger at the dinosaur's massive sail, which he realized was its only weak point. Sure enough, the dagger cut through the sail and seemed to hurt the dinosaur more so than even the acid. Still, it didn't appear to do any lasting harm. Once again, however, the dinosaur's attention was diverted, and it pursued Triolex, who wisely didn't attempt to fight back like Kreleg had. Kreleg, meanwhile, limped over to the small lake the Spinosaurus had come from and puked the acidic substance from his stomach into it, until eventually the lake started to boil. He then waited a few moments for his hands and his tail to grow back, whilst Triolex constantly attempted to dodge the angry Spinosaurus. At one point, the beast managed to corner him against a wall, but he was able to escape by bringing his sword down on one of the acid burns on its snout when it moved forward to bite him. Once Kreleg had recovered, he fired another round of acid at the Spinosaurus's tail, and made sure to hit the already existing burn marks. The animal charged at him in response, but as it got near the now bubbling lake, it stopped. Clearly it was smarter than he thought. Both Triolex and Kreleg surrounded the dinosaur from both sides, with the animal ready to strike in case either of them came near. Trialex responded by throwing another one of his daggers at the dinosaur's sail again, and whilst it was briefly distracted by the pain, Kreleg jumped onto the dinosaur and wrapped his tail around its throat again, though this time he spat his acid onto its neck and jumped down before it could reach him with its claws. The animal then tumbled backwards towards the lake, though it still didn't fall in. A few blasts of acid towards its stomach, which was now exposed as it was leaning upright in order to clutch its throat, followed by a few more towards its feet, finally sent it tumbling backwards into the lake of acid. Kreleg quickly slithered backwards towards Trialex and pushed him to safety out of the way of the acid, splashed when the Spinosaurus fell back into it. Fortunately, he managed to get the assassin to safety in time, much to Trialex's surprise.
"Well, I owed you one,"
the monster said, almost hating having to admit that. Trialex, however, still thanked his six-armed ally and went to fetch the prisoners from down the tunnel. Unfortunately, however, the Spinosaurus wasn't dead yet. It rose out of the boiling water, its sail having completely melted off, its body covered in burns, and one of its eyes having melted out of its skull. The dinosaur reached out with its single claw, which it impaled through Kreleg's tail, pinning him like a worm on a hook. Before Trialex could even respond, it then pulled Kreleg back towards it and bit his torso while stabbing its other claw into his chest. The dinosaur then pulled with both of its claws and ripped Kreleg into three pieces, before spitting out his midsection and scooping up his top half in its jaws, which it crunched to pieces before finally spitting the mangled remains into the acid bath below. Much like how the owl felt about the vampires, the Spinosaurus evidently regarded monsters as too toxic to actually eat, but it was still not above using those powerful jaws to crush them to paste. The giant reptile then lurched awkwardly out of the pool of acid, stepping on the remains of Kreleg's torso, which it crushed into powder. However, the dinosaur only managed to walk a few feet towards Trialex before it collapsed onto the ground. Trialex had heard about the tremendous power of the Spinosaurus, but how the creature could even be alive after a bath in that acid was incredible. He'd seen Kreleg's acid eat through reinforced steel. Still, it was obvious that even the mighty sail-backed predator was finished as it still desperately tried to crawl along the floor. Trialex put the dinosaur out of its misery with a sword straight between the eyes. It had to stab it in one of Kreleg's acid burns, as that was the easiest to puncture, but at least within a few seconds the dinosaur was dead at last. Trialex then led the prisoners past its corpse and the still twitching remains of Kreleg's tail, which was all that remained of him. Incredibly, and disturbingly enough, Kreleg's tail was still trying to repair itself and grow into something else. It wouldn't be able to bring him back, however. His people's healing capabilities were beyond most other creatures, to the point where, even after death, their bodies would still attempt to repair themselves for days afterwards. However, once they had actually died, that was it. Trialex didn't know how to feel. He certainly couldn't mourn Kreleg. He was a sadistic killer who had slaughtered scores of innocent people, both for profit and his own pleasure. Still, he had saved Trialex's life, and so the Venusian gave a simple bow of his head to the acid pool that contained his fellow assassin's remains and moved on. The prisoners were out of the mine, but they still had a long way to go. The centaur, meanwhile, went to help Makos and the other assassins who were being overwhelmed by the vampires. Despite their superior powers, there were just too many of the bloodsuckers for the assassins to deal with. The vampires didn't care how many of their comrades died. They'd happily sacrifice themselves, as they knew that failure was not an option for Classia. Sadly, when the centaur arrived, He wasn't able to provide much help either. His brief attack, however, did distract the vampires long enough for the assassins to sit by the vampire horde, though they all soon found themselves running for their lives. Despite his power, Makos had been gravely wounded, with one of the vampires managing to strike him in the leg by ironically hiding in the hole in the ground the shark man himself had made. The wound would heal very quickly, but none of the other assassins wanted to wait around, so the centaur picked Makos up and placed him over its back before riding away. Unfortunately, however, the assassins soon found vampires coming down almost every corridor they tried to flee down. Fastian, meanwhile, couldn't simply phase through the walls as the vampires had come prepared for that, and indeed any form of spectral invasion with powerful magic that ran throughout the entire base. Eventually, the assassins came to a dead end. However, there was a hole in the floor at the very end of the corridor. Fastian was hesitant to go down for obvious reasons. What could possibly be so horrible that the vampires couldn't keep it up here?